Hello humans, welcome back to Dr. Rose Helps You Hear. I'm Stephani Rose and I'm an audiologist. Today we're going to be discussing musical ear syndrome. Musical ear syndrome is also known as musical tinnitus or musical hallucination. Sometimes people also refer to it as an auditory hallucination, but it's usually of the non-psychiatric kind. So what is it? Well, musical ear syndrome or musical tinnitus, whatever you want to call it, is basically the perception of music when there's no external music playing. So you have this experience of hearing the music like it's actually in the room, not just remembering what a song sounds like. What we do know is that we can classify it as a disorder of the processing of complex sounds. I've studied several scientific articles for you to bring you some more information about this subject, so I'll put links to those in the description if you want to take a look at them for yourself. A review study in 2009 by Cope et al. Titled, Is Musical Hallucination an Otological Phenomenon? It was actually a review of several research articles. And what they found is that the association reported is definitely with hearing loss. Predominantly female, usually over the age of 60 years old, but not necessarily, those are not necessarily risk factors for having MES. They found that underlying causes can be neurovascular pathways that have pathology, or psychiatric disorders, or opioid medications, but these are mostly absent in a majority of the cases. The otologic system does play a role, and hearing loss may act as the initiating factor. So we see hearing loss a lot in patients who have the musical ear syndrome. And the primary dysfunction they found between all these research articles is in the auditory association cortex. And we'll get into more specific points with a later study that looked at fMRI images of people who were actively having musical ear syndrome or musical tinnitus. The first line of treatment, after excluding any other serious factors, would be, you know, explaining to the patient what it is, and then also to optimize the hearing. I have experienced in my career at least one, maybe two patients that had this. One of them was very affected by it and it bothered her a lot. The other one seemed to be able to cope with it more. In both of these cases, unfortunately, aiding the hearing loss did not really help as much as they had wanted it to. It was still definitely there, even when wearing the hearing aids. Another patient that I had fit said that it was slightly reduced, but definitely still prominent. Another interesting study I found for you was musical ear syndrome in adult cochlear implant patients. There was only one study in this patient population up to this date, and this one was in 2013. By Low et al. At Cambridge University. There were 82 patients in this study, and they found they were all over 18, the age of 18, and those who received cochlear implants, 22% of them had musical ear syndrome. Now keep in mind, you know, 7 out of those 82 patients had the musical ear syndrome before the surgery or before getting a cochlear implant, but 11 out of the 82 had it after. So they noted that this did affect their emotional state, but most coped pretty well, it said. So musical ear syndrome can occur prior to and after cochlear implantation. There's another study I found out of the Department of Neurology in Istanbul, Turkey, at Metepe University, and I'm sorry if I said that wrong, Metepe University School of Medicine in 2014. This one found that you have to be careful when patients are exhibiting this in advanced age because that can be very confused with dementia. So there has to be careful testing done to rule out if it's one or the other. They found that musical ear syndrome is suggested to be a variant of Charles Bonnet syndrome. This is when people who have visual impairments or blindness have visual hallucinations and can actually have a misfire in the visual cortex. So that's kind of interesting, and it kind of makes sense to me when I found that fact. It does say that it's frequently seen but rarely diagnosed, and that even though we don't know the mechanism that's caused by this, it's definitely a hypersensitivity in the auditory cortex. they also associated it with sensory deprivation. So usually there is a correlation with hearing loss, why we're getting this kind of misfire in the auditory cortex. And they reported that people said that it can sound like popular music or orchestral music, sometimes radio tunes. So you can have actual singing along with this, not just instrumental music, and it really does sound like it's in the sound field, so in the room with you. Sometimes it can sound like it's coming from another room. I had a lady who lived next to like a high school, and she could have sworn that the band was practicing at like 3 a.m. and made several complaints. So it was a very real sound to her. So that's that one. Last one I have for you is spontaneous musical auditory perceptions in patients who have abrupt bilateral sensory neural hearing loss. So this is the one that did the fMRI study of the brain while people were having the musical ear syndrome, and they found that the area of focus where it's happening is area 39 of Brodmann, which is the locus for auditory memory. They said that stored musical memory can be released and a person has musical perceptions without an external source. It's likely that the abrupt loss of the hearing or inner ear function might uninhibit, so that means not stop, neuronal groups for storing auditory memory. So something goes wrong, and for whatever reason, the brain just releases all this auditory memory. You start hearing all this music. For the most part, this is completely benign. It doesn't necessarily mean it's an indicator for something that's a terrible disease. I think that maybe cognitive behavioral therapy or CBT might be useful in this, along with treating the hearing loss. So I will go ahead and post these different interesting articles for you guys. I hope you have a great rest of your week. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe if you like my videos, and I'll see you next week.
Some people call me an audiologist. Others call me a hearing nerd. Being human with hearing loss is like my superpower. As a hearing doctor, I get to help people hear their best while learning about the mysteries of hearing.